My name is Scott Galloway, Clinical Professor of Marketing with NYU Stern. It's my pleasure to be the host and moderator for our last session. We spend a lot of time today taking data and intellectual property out of the classroom and bringing it to you. And what we wanted to do in this session was try to take you into the classroom briefly to give you a feel for what our students are experiencing at Stern. And for those of you who are alumni, if you think about the real inspirational or seminal moments in your graduate career, we would argue that a lot of times that happens in the classroom. And despite all the talk about MOOCs and upside down classes and online learning, real moments of inspiration take place in the classroom. And so today we're going to bring you three segments, three subclasses, each about 20, 25 minutes in length to give you a sense of what it's like to be a student and pushing out into one of the most competitive economies and how we'd like to think that we're inspiring change and broadening people's possibilities and capabilities. So with that, this is the first and the last slide that you will see today or in this session, and it's our objectives and it's how you hold us accountable for your investment in 90 minutes here today. The first is to provide a window into the Stern classroom, and the second objective is to provide texture on the word possible. And we'll speak more about that as we go on. Our tagline is an education impossible, and it was difficult to come up with, and it's meaningful, and it is something that in fact guides us, and hopefully through the course of this session, you'll see that it is a relevant term for us. Three professors, Professor Luke Williams, Rob Salomon, and myself, so we're gonna kick right into it. Luke Williams is a clinical associate professor and also the executive director of the Berkley Center for Entrepreneurship. Luke, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Scott. Hello, everyone. How's it been so far? Good? Yeah, all right, good. I'm very excited to be here with you in Shanghai because I think the opportunity to get together like this and collaborate and hear different ideas is so important, and it just doesn't happen enough where you can get out of the day-to-day activity of whatever you're doing and come and mix with people from a diverse range of industries with different points of view. In fact, it happens so rarely that the social scientists actually have a name for this. They call it self-similarity principle. So we like hanging out with people that are very much like ourselves, reinforce our own viewpoint. In fact, some researchers at Columbia University in New York in 2007 did a research on, they wanted to see how well business executives actually mixed with people from different industries. So they invited them to a cocktail party. Now their stated objective was to meet as many different people from diverse backgrounds as possible to expand their social network. And all the business executives said, yes, no problem, I can do that. But the researchers, Paul Ingram and Michael Morris, were able to track every conversation that went on through RFID technology and the name tags, the same technology we're using to do the interactive displays. And what they found was the complete opposite happened. So the bankers just chatted with the other bankers. The marketers just hung out with the other marketers. The accountants just made small talk with the other accountants. Actually, to be fair, nobody wanted to be in that conversation. The researchers concluded that the only person that successfully achieved the objective and met as many people from diverse backgrounds and expanded their social network was the bartender. Most economic growth has a very simple source. And that source is new ideas. It is our creativity that generates wealth. And I think to be interested in innovation, you have to passionately believe this. Because if you think about it, without creativity, there would be absolutely no progress. Now, one of the biggest challenges for us in the 21st century leadership is, how do we increase the pace of innovation and new idea generation? How do we, and last time I was in China, I heard a lot of this, how do we inspire more people like Steve Jobs? How do we learn to inspire more Picassos? And we're not talking, this is a business school conference, so I'm not talking about artists in terms of painting. But I'm talking about the creative productivity of someone like Picasso. We need these same people generating, not paintings, but new business models. Business models can be works of art, the same as any painting can be. And in fact, it was Picasso who once said, every child is born an artist. The challenge is to remain an artist when one grows up through our education. And this is central, I believe, to how we think about and define an education impossible. Now, I spoke at the Global Alumni Conference 2 years ago in London with Professor Romer. Professor Paul Romer, Professor of Economics, spoke at the conference. And I left my presentation quoting from Professor Romer, saying, ideas are the recipes that we use to rearrange things to generate new value and wealth. So I basically wanted to kick off from where I left off last time because, I mean, frankly, they only gave me 12 minutes last time. So as I was saying, Professor Romer wrote a very important paper called, the common term for it, the layman's term was New Growth Theory. It had a much more fancy name than that. Now, in it, if you Google New Growth Theory, what you will find is a whole lot of equations that, frankly, I don't understand. But at the essence of New Growth Theory is a very profoundly simple idea, which is ideas are an inexhaustible resource. Professor Romer basically said that economic growth or wealth is often rooted in our understanding of scarcity in the material world. But he defined ideas as a non-rival good, which means that knowledge and ideas aren't worn out the more we use them. In fact, they become more valuable. So think about something like a bicycle. We'll take for granted. If I have one bicycle, that's extremely valuable to me. Now, if you give me a second bicycle, not so valuable. Can't do much with that. If you give me a third bicycle, even less value. But think about the recipe for a bicycle. There is a recipe. It's just that it was invented so long ago, we've all forgotten. But there's a recipe for how you take the raw materials, you form the materials to create a bicycle. Now, the recipe is what's important. Because the more you tell people about this recipe, this idea for a bicycle, the more people will come back with useful new additions to what you can do with a bicycle. And they're adding their own ideas to this new recipe. So ideas tend to become more useful when they become more popular. And this is an important point because as innovators, we're in the business of idea sharing. This is the most important thing that we do. So consumption of ideas leads to increasing returns and new innovations. And again, increasing returns is an economics principle, but basically I think of it like a bowl of nuts. If you're eating a mixed bowl of nuts, say that you're obsessed with cashews like I am. I'm always looking for the cashews. So pretty soon, the cashews are all gone and I'm left with all the other nuts that I don't want to eat. Now imagine if you had this bowl of mixed nuts and the more cashews you ate, the more cashews would come into the bowl. It's an inexhaustible source of cashews. This is what New Growth Theory is about, the increasing returns behind ideas. So when ideas are shared, they don't just add up. They multiply. Now, the biggest question for an education impossible that we're asking ourselves is how do we create a multiplier culture? So I'm going to talk about three meta ideas. So think about meta ideas as basically big, broad ideas that support the spread of other ideas. So here are three meta ideas for thinking about how to create a multiplier culture. The first is expanding our students and our own perceptual scope. Perception is so important. to creativity and innovation. You know, I used to work at a design company, and when you work at a design company, every client wants an iPod. Doesn't matter what it is. If they're in the business of making cars and you say, what do you want your car to be like? They will say, we want it to be like an iPod. For some reason, this is the holy grail of product design. And when we say, what do you like about the iPod? Inevitably, they say, I've heard everybody say this, the first thing that comes out of their mouth is, I like it because it looks clean. The original iPod, I love it because it looks clean. Now, we were wondering why is that the first thing they say? Now, we knew it was white, it hardly had any buttons, but we thought there must be a deeper convention going on here that's affecting people's perception of why the iPod looks clean. Now, a designer came into the office a bit more excited than usual one day, and he said, Luke, I've figured it out. I understand why everybody perceives the iPod as looking clean. He said, I was sitting on the toilet last night, and this is, of course, where most good ideas come from. And I was looking around, and I saw the shiny white porcelain of the bathtub, and I saw the shiny chrome of the faucet, and I said, that's it. Everyone perceives the iPod as looking clean because it references bathroom materials. Now, we thought this was a little far-fetched. But then we looked up the bio of the man responsible for the design of the iPod and who leads the Apple industrial design team, a guy called Jonathan Ive. And guess what job Jonathan had just before he joined Apple? He worked at a consultancy, and 80% of the work they did was design toilets and bathroom fixtures. So coincidence? I think not. But it's the forcing together of these disparate ideas. This is where insight comes from. And by definition, an insight is a new configuration of knowledge. And we need to give students the confidence to come up with mind-blowing insights that can lead to game-changing ideas in every industry. Because the world is changing so fast. We haven't seen anything yet. The changes in consumer behavior are going to be counterintuitive to everyone in this room. Because nobody in this room grew up in the digital generation. I'll give you a quick example. A raise of hands. How many people here are wearing a wristwatch today? Okay, that's most of the room. Now, if I was in an audience of teenagers and I asked this question, hardly a single hand would go up. It's not that they can't wear watches or they're told not to, it's that they choose not to. Because they grew up in a digital world where time is all around them. I have a cousin that's 20. She doesn't wear a watch. She thinks it's lame. She said to me, why on earth would I want to wear a single function device? And I said, no. It tells the date as well. This girl is only 1 year old. Now, if anyone's seen children playing with new technology like iPhones or iPads, isn't it remarkable? And they just slide that across and they seem to be ordering apps before they're even talking. Look at this little 1 year old. The problem isn't with the technology, the problem occurs when she goes back to a traditional magazine. She's about to test if her finger still works on her knee. Watch this.
Hey,
Now, this is staggering. This is staggering. I mean, it's hard to overstate how much the world has changed, even in the last 100 years. I mean, Facebook is now the third largest country on the planet. Right? Now, there's a raft of literature out there indicating that, you know, we've been through different eras. We've been through the agricultural age. We've been through the industrial age. We've been through the information age or the knowledge economy. Particularly in the West, the literature is saying we're moving into a new age, which is off, so we're leaving the information age, the knowledge economy, which most of our educational systems have been set up to support, and we're entering an age often referred to as the creative age, the conceptual age, the disruptive age, where many of the certainties that we thought we knew about business, how the world works, and consumer behavior, etc., are no longer so certain. And it's putting a premium on a new set of skills, and right at the top of that set of skills is a comfortable fluency with the skills of creative thinking, innovation, and entrepreneurship, even if you work in a government agency or a large organization. It's the mindset that's important. So this is the second meta idea to encourage this mindset, and this is critical. It's what we call provocation. It's the ability to be wrong at the start in order to be right at the end. You know, there was a computer scientist working in the early 80s called Doug Lenot. He was working in an artificial intelligence program called Eurisco. And he got to the point where he wanted to see what this artificial intelligence program could actually do. So he entered a war game tournament. This is a tournament where you get a big room like this, competitors are squaring off against each other, playing a highly computerized version of Battleship. Each competitor gets a mythical budget of $1 trillion to design their war fleet. Now, most competitors take that $1 trillion and design their war fleet based on best practice Navy principles. So you need a large array of different size ships, all heavily armed and highly maneuverable. So Doug decided to feed the rules of the tournament to Eurisco to see if the artificial intelligence program would suggest a new strategy, a new hypothesis. So Eurisco crunched the data and spat back out new data, which suggested a new way of approaching this strategy. It said, instead of 12 to 15 ships in an armada, how about we send in 1,000 ships? And because we have so many, we don't need to spend money on guns and they don't need to move. So this is what Doug did. He turned up at the tournament with 1,000 ships just sitting there. So everyone was laughing at him, going, what is this? However, the other competitors couldn't sink all his ships in the time allotted. So basically, Doug, through the entire tournament, did not touch the keyboard. He was just having a drink while the others were madly trying to shoot all his ships. He won the tournament in a landslide. Now, this annoyed a lot of people. So he decided to enter the second year, and the judges were so annoyed with him, they said, you know what, Doug? We didn't like you just having 1,000 ships sitting there. So this year, we're entering a new criteria, agility. The ships have to move. So Doug fed this rule and the old rules back into Eurisco. Eurisco crunched the data and suggested a new hypothesis. What if we sink our own ships the moment they get damaged? Now, I'm assuming, you know, many people probably haven't been in the Navy here, so let me use an example that's a bit closer to home. Assume most people have gone on a walk with other people or a hike. What happens in the middle of that walk, somebody sprains their ankle? Right? Overall walking party agility goes down. You've got to wait for hop along. Now what if, hypothetically, you took out a gun Dean Henry, you enjoyed that a little bit too much. Overall walking party agility goes back up. Everyone's back in time for lunch. And this is exactly what happened. Doug won the tournament in a landslide again. He was going to enter for a third year in a row, and they said, Doug, if you enter again, we're not going to bother doing the tournament. So he bowed out gracefully. What was going on here? Basically, the other competitors were steeped in military history and strategy. They could tell you exactly how Napoleon was outfoxed at Waterloo. They grew up playing Dungeons and Dragons. But Doug had no interest in military strategy. And Eurisco, the artificial intelligence program, did not have any common sense. We often say this, at NYU Stern, at least in terms of innovation, nothing kills an idea faster than common sense. Common sense is the tyranny of all new ideas. You need plenty of common sense at other parts of the process, but at the start of creating something new, it will kill you every time. So the other competitors were filling in the gaps between the rules with their own common sense based on best practice Navy principles. Eurisco was filling in the gaps between the rules with what Doug Freely admits are socially horrific hypotheses. Nobody in their right mind with any common sense is going to say, let's send 1,000 ships into battle that can't defend themselves and can't move. Nobody with any common sense is going to say, why don't we sink our own ships the moment they get damaged? And this is exactly why nobody else had thought of it this way before. It was unthinkable. And there are unthinkables in every business. And part of our challenge is encouraging our students to think about the unthinkable, places where other people don't dare to create. And it doesn't mean everything has to be socially horrific, but it just means you have to surface the unthinkables of your business. Now, the final meta idea is possibility. This is expanding our experimental scope. Because it's one thing to expand a perceptual scope, so I see more opportunities. It's one thing to expand conceptual scope, which is what provocation's about, meaning I consider more of those opportunities that I see instead of dismissing them. But the really important one is we have to experiment with ideas. Now, most of us lose this instinct to experiment and play with ideas by the time we're grown up. You know, this is a real lawsuit. It would be funnier if it isn't, but it's a real lawsuit. Basically, a mad as heck Manhattan mother filed a lawsuit in New York saying her daughter's Ivy League dreams have been all but dashed and she's only 4 years old. Nicole Williams, I should say no relation, is suing the $19,000 a year York Avenue preschool saying her daughter, Lucy, was forced to spend too much time with lesser-minded 2 and 3 year olds. When what she really should have been doing is focusing on test preparation to get her into an elite school. The lawsuit concluded that indeed the school proved not to be a school at all, but just one big playroom. Now, I remind you that this is kindergarten. Now, I don't have time to go into the importance of kindergarten actually being one big playroom. But what I will say is, particularly in America, and I'm not sure of the situation in China, but the competition to get children into elite schools is getting ridiculous, to the point where you have little three-year-olds lining up in front of unimpressed adult panels, basically flicking through their resumes. What? This is it? You've been around for 36 months and this is it? You've achieved nothing. Spent the first 6 months breastfeeding, from what I can see. Look at this little guy. He's only 18 months old. Now, when was the last time anyone in this room felt that they could experiment with crazy ideas without any fear of ridicule whatsoever? When was the last time you were actually given deliberate permission to actually do that? Children don't need that permission. Look at this guy. He's experimenting with the dance moves to Beyoncé's All the Single Ladies without any fear of ridicule whatsoever.
This is hilarious.
That's my favorite part, because the poor little guy, I mean, it's all an experiment in weight distribution because he can't support his own weight yet. So it's all about experimenting, but then Beyonce starts using her hands a lot more. So he has to make a decision. He has to try something new. Yes. All right. At the end of the day, this is about mindset, and this is so critically important to 21st century leadership. It's developing an instinct for change in our students and in our community. A rebellious instinct to want to discard old business assumptions and cliches and remake the market landscape. An eagerness to target situations where customers have been continually underserved or overlooked. An eagerness to take on competition that has been complacent. There has never been a better time for us to be thinking about how to structure or restructure our approach to creativity and innovation to create a new blueprint for what that looks like in the 21st century. And as our alumni community, we invite you to join us in this exciting journey. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Scott.
Don't go anywhere. Real quick. So Luke is the author of a successful book called Disruption, and you're writing a book called The Disruptive Leader.
Correct.
What are the traits in an executive who tends to be more innovative or disruptive than his peer group?
You know, I think the more I think in research provocation, it's critically important. You know, I started my career in a big, large corporation. Mm-hmm. And the general consensus about creativity and innovation was that you need to build a culture of trust where people feel safe to present their ideas. Now, when I started working for Frog Design, who have done the amazing work with the concepts out here, they're one of the leading innovation firms in the world. I came from Australia to America, and the founder was a guy called Hartman Esslinger. Mm-hmm. And he's literally crazy. This is why him and Steve Jobs got along so well, I think. They developed the first Apple Macintosh together and other things. But my first creative review with Hartman, we had to get all the sketches and ideas up on a wall. And I was terrified, because it's so public. Your talent can't hide. Mm-hmm. Hartman would go up, if he saw ideas that he didn't like, he would rip up the sketches, take them off the wall, throw them in the bin, throw them at you sometimes. It was terrifying stuff. But what it forced us to do was get rid of the notion that ideas are precious. And nothing inspired me more to work harder, to get more ideas up. If I knew that 10 ideas were going to be ripped up, I wanted to have 20 up there. So it got me over this actual fear of new ideas and innovation. So it was the complete opposite to what a lot of the academic theory says about building this sort of safe environment of trust. So I think provocation, and Hartman was a provocateur, mm-hmm. is perhaps the key ingredient for 21st century disruptive leaders.
Thanks very much, Luke.
Thanks, Scott.
Rob Salomon is an associate professor of international management. Professor Salomon, where are you?
Great. Thanks, Scott. Thanks for having me today. I have to say, this is not the first time I've had the unenviable task of following Luke Williams in a presentation. We've done a couple programs together, and usually it goes something like this. At the end, people come to me and say, "That Luke Williams guy, not only is he smarter and more interesting than you are, but he's also better looking, and he has a much sexier accent." So my apologies to you in advance that my last name does not begin with Williams. But welcome to my classroom. Let me take you into a look into the kinds of things that I do with my students. And today, what I'll be talking about is globalization. And no better fitting setting than here today to be speaking about globalization. But in particular, I'll be talking about globalization in the context of how companies deal with globalization and how they think about the challenges that they face in their international expansion endeavors. Now, to start, I'm going to rekindle an existing debate. One that's gone on now for several years between Thomas Friedman. How many people in this room have read Thomas Friedman's book, The World is Flat? My apologies. And Pankaj Ghemawat, who spends some of his time at NYU and is a scholar, and they debate whether or not the world truly is global. Is it flat, as Thomas Friedman would like us to believe, or is it not as flat as some may have us think? Now, the received wisdom, and many of my students come into class this very same way, the received wisdom is, we cannot wait to hit the ground running. There are so many exciting opportunities in China, in India, in Brazil, in Russia. We can't wait to get there. And I always have to remind them that this received wisdom, that the world is rapidly globalizing, so much so that borders don't really even matter anymore. Therefore, companies that don't globalize and aren't a part of this globalization process will be left behind. And they come in thinking that if you are not global, therefore you will not succeed. Now, the interesting thing about this is, while yes, I would absolutely agree that we are more globalized today than we were 20 or 30 years ago, and as a stylized point in fact, I just point you to this conference. 20 years ago, this conference probably never could have happened here. Maybe the Sheraton West Orange, but certainly not Shanghai. But that said, the reality on globalization is much more modest than many in the popular press would have you believe. We are less global than we think. Some stylized facts, again, and I have to thank Pankaj Ghemawat for bringing some of these statistics to our collective attention. Believe it or not, only about 2% of the world's phone calls cross national borders. 2%. About 3% of the world's population consists of immigrants. First-generation immigrants. Well, you say, what about global investment? We've heard a lot, even here today in this room, about global investment and global trade. Of all of the global investment that happened last year, the total worldwide investment, only 10% of that investment was accounted for by foreign direct investment. And even if we want to look at a statistic like world trade, global trade as a percentage of global GDP, we're really only talking about 20% of global GDP is comprised of world trade. Now, let's think about Facebook. Facebook has been lauded for its ability to create a borderless world where you now have 1 billion members connected with Facebook accounts. Only a little over 10% of any of those members have friends outside their home country. And believe it or not, of all the corporate entities in this world, only about 1%, less than 1%, have any foreign operations, so to speak. Now, the reality is that most of us in this room are in that 1%. And like I said, I would not be here to say we are not globalizing. We surely are. But the reality is that the free movement of goods, services, and people, which is the general definition of globalization, we still stand a far cry from that. And the interesting thing is when you talk to executives and you speak to them about their global expansion, the reality is that most companies perform worse in foreign markets than they do in their own domestic markets. A few more stylized facts. Some of this has been informed by my own research. Foreign firms pay higher wages than domestic firms, on average. Foreign firms take longer to start up their operations And it costs them more to start their operations than similar domestic firms. As a matter of fact, some research that I published about 11 years ago demonstrates that it takes 3 to 6 months longer for a foreign firm to set up its operations than if equivalent domestic firm had set up the equivalent exact same facility. Foreign firms are subject to more lawsuits than domestic firms, and they're more likely to lose litigation than a domestic firm. And they have a higher probability of failure. And not surprisingly, even for those that seem to survive and succeed in foreign markets, on average, foreign subsidiaries have lower operating margins than domestic subsidiaries. They have lower profitability. And a new study that I'm working on right now demonstrates that they're way behind similar domestic firms when it comes to productivity. So when we think about this, we have to ask this question of why do companies continue to struggle in foreign markets? If the world truly were flat, expanding to another country wouldn't matter. It'd be equivalent to operating in your own domestic environment. But we know that it's not. All of the research tells us it's not. So what is it about foreign markets that makes it so difficult for foreign companies to operate there? And the key here is the institutional differences across markets. Companies are born, grow up, and develop generally in their own domestic context. They know how to operate within their own domestic context. It's much more difficult for them to go to a foreign country and to acclimate to a completely different institutional environment. What do we mean by that? Institutional environment. And we've heard Dean Henry speak about institutions. And my colleagues in economics and political science, and psychology and anthropology, like to speak of three different kinds of institutions. Cultural institutions, political institutions or regulatory institutions, and economic institutions. Because these sets of institutions differ across countries, it's so much more difficult for companies that expand into new markets to succeed. The bar is set that much higher. All of these differences across these institutional environments and countries create what we call the liability of foreignness, which are defined as the costs associated with being a foreigner in a foreign land. Just by virtue of the fact that you are not from there, you are starting from behind. You're at a disadvantage. And you can think about this not only in terms of organizations or institutions that operate across borders, but also individuals who do immigrate or emigrate from one country to another. You know, my father, God bless him, he's been in the United States for 50 years. He still feels like there are certain things that put him at a disadvantage relative to native-born Americans. And he's right. The same thing holds at the organizational level. It's much harder for organizations to cross boundaries into a new institutional environment and perform well. So, if you buy my hypothesis, or my thesis, that global expansion is extremely difficult and raises the costs for companies that want to expand abroad, the question then becomes, is there some way to quantify it? Can we price the risk? Is there some way that you can look at this problem and say, oh, okay, you are a Chinese company and you want to expand into the United States? Well, I know that's going to be difficult. And I know that's going to be difficult because the cultures are different, the political environments are different, the economic institutions are different. Can we price that? Can I say, for that Chinese company, how much is this going to cost you? So I've been working a lot over the past 6 or 7 years on this problem of how do we price this liability of foreignness cost that foreign firms bear. And if we take it that at the root of these liability of foreignness costs are cultural, political, economic, geographic, regulatory differences across countries, if we can measure them, we can price them. We can price them. So how do we measure them? There are lots of measures out there of these institutions. You can turn to many sources. Anthropologists and psychologists have created measures of culture for years. And there are ample places you can go to, freely available to all, where you can access these data. The same goes for political and regulatory risk or regulatory institutions. There are many of these sources of data out there that are freely available. Ditto for economic risk or the differences in economic institutions across countries. These are just a sampling of the kinds of places that you can turn if you'd like to think about, well, what's it going to cost me to go there? I've spoken with many CFOs, including esteemed graduates of our own institution, who tell me, well, you know, we know that going there is going to be costly, and we know it's going to be different, but we don't know how to price it. So I don't know what to do, for example, with my IRR hurdle rate if I'm expanding, let's say, from the United States to Germany. I can't use my domestic hurdle rate. Or what do I do with my discount rate? I can't use my domestic discount rate because that doesn't adequately price the additional costs and risks that I'll be facing if I enter this foreign environment. So I have all my students develop their own risk pricing model. And over the last 7 years or so, I've developed my own, which is called Global Acumen. This is a sampling of what the inputs are to Global Acumen and its architecture. So if you think about it, you start with political inputs, cultural inputs, and economic inputs. And you say to yourself, how do these countries stack up on these institutional measures? And not just stack up, how do these countries stand relative to each other in their political institutions, economic institutions, and cultural institutions? That's what we're most interested in. Country one relative to country two. The greater the differences in economic institutions, cultural institutions, and political institutions, the more difficult and the greater the cost it is to me of expanding there. So we take all these inputs and we calculate from them political factors, cultural factors, and economic factors. And then what we do is we put those three factors into a bowl, we mix them up with a recipe, and what pops out at the end is a spread, a risk adjustment spread. So now, for example, if I'm an American company and I'm going to be expanding into China, I know that I need to add some risk spread on top of my hurdle rate, my domestic hurdle rate, in order to compensate me for the extra costs of doing business in a foreign location. And just to give you an example of two of these risk spreads. So for China, the risk spread for a US company entering into China would be about 16%, 15.7% more or less. So what that would suggest is if you have a domestic rate or domestic discount rate of 10%, you should add another 16% on top of that to compensate you for the added risk that you'll be taking by entering China. And the way the algorithm works is that for any two countries that you give me, it spits out a spread. This is the spread for a US company expanding to China. But the interesting thing is, it's not symmetric. just because it's 16% for a US company entering into China, the commensurate spread for a Chinese firm entering in the United States is actually only 12%. Now let's look at a US-based firm entering into Canada. Canada is a market that we tend to think of as institutionally similar in many ways to the United States, but still different enough that it poses some challenges. The spread, by contrast, for Canada is 4%. So again, if you are a US-based firm and you are entering into Canada, you would need to add to your discount rate or your IRR hurdle rate an additional 4% spread. And I know that many folks in this room, my finance colleagues who I speak with about this, like to say, well, what about the market risk premium? What about the market risk premium across each of the countries that you're looking at? And I say, well, you can't simply use the market risk premium for several reasons. The first one is a market risk premium will only tell you what the rate of return that's required for domestic investors making domestic investments. And the second that I would submit, that I always speak to my finance colleagues about, is that if we just look at the market risk premium, you're only looking at one part of the equation. You're looking only at the economic risk part. You're not looking at the cultural risk or the political regulatory risk in that particular environment. Now, there are several ways to modify this base model, and this base model has an algorithm, let's call it 30-30-30. Say 30% is economic factors, 30% is cultural factors, 30% is political factors. Well, now the interesting thing is you can change the weightings based on several different criteria. The first one is your industry characteristics. So for example, the energy industry. Well, if you're in the energy industry, political factors matter a whole heck of a lot. And so what you can do is then take the weighting of the political factors and raise that to more than 30-30-30, 40-20, 25-25, 50-20-30. Take another industry, like the retail industry. Well, in retail, branded goods, cultural factors might matter more. And so what you can do, again, is go back to the base weightings and change those to elevate the cultural risk factor versus the economic or the political. Another thing that you can do is weight it by governance equity structure, by the governance or the equity structure that the firm uses. A lot of people talk about the value of having a local partner. Well, one of the values of having a local partner is that you don't have to bear all of those liability of foreignness costs, those additional costs of doing business yourself. You have a partner help you to navigate the local environment. So what you can do then is take the model, and if you're doing a 50-50 joint venture, you can take those liability of foreignness risk costs and multiply them by 0.5, by your level of equity in the venture itself. And by experience. One of the things that my research demonstrates is that over time and with experience, companies get better at operating in the local environment. They don't ever, well, I hesitate to use the word ever, they don't usually catch up to be equivalent to domestic firms, but they get better at what they do. So then what you can do with experience is with your first investment, you might use a 16% risk spread in China. But your second now, 15%, then 14%, then 12.5%, then 11%, then 9%. And this model can not only be used, global acumen can not only be used to make decisions about which countries to enter, how to enter those countries, but also to evaluate ongoing operations. Have we met our targets? You can use this as a basis for evaluating your ongoing subsidiary operations and say, are they meeting the goals we set out when we initially made those decisions 3 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago? So just to bring it back, as large a proponent as I am of globalization, and make no mistake, I am absolutely a proponent of globalization. Global expansion for companies is still not as easy as many tend to believe. We have these liability of foreignness costs that make it difficult for foreign firms to operate in foreign locations. And so how can you overcome these constraints of being a foreigner in a foreign land? Well, you build a careful risk pricing model. How do you do that? You use cultural, political, economic differences across countries to price that risk. And in my class, I challenge each and every one of my students to build these models on their own. As a matter of fact, the final deliverable is to create their own variant of global acumen. So I'd just like to thank you for your time, and thank you for indulging me in speaking today about globalization and international risk pricing.
So real quick, Rob, if your thesis is right, that companies have overinvested in globalization, then isn't there an accretive effect if a lot of firms were to retrench back to their home markets? Are you saying there's opportunity to deglobalize for corporations?
I don't know necessarily that the answer is to deglobalize. I do know that the statistics demonstrate that foreign firms fail at a much higher rate than domestic firms. Mm-hmm. So I am comfortable saying that managers systematically tend to overestimate the benefits of international expansion and systematically tend to underestimate the costs associated with international expansion. Mm-hmm. Now, the question is the prescription that they should not be doing these things? Not that they shouldn't be doing them, but that they should make more careful decisions about how they go about it. So does that mean you would see potentially fewer international expansions in an mm-hmm. ideal, optimized world? Mm-hmm. Yeah, probably. Yeah. Good. But does that mean those who are currently abroad should pack up and go home? No, I wouldn't make that prescription.
Good. Thanks, Rob.
Thanks.
So to wrap, we're going to talk a little bit about some of the work we're doing at Stern around luxury. And there are a lot of MBA firms offering great curriculums in luxury. Ours is a little bit different in that we're trying to take more of a rigorous approach. When I think of the Stern brand, I think of this wonderful cocktail of rigor, creativity, and grit. And the entire prestige industry has suffered from a lack of rigor and data. So we're trying to approach this environment and this growing sector from a position of data and rigor, as opposed to one from art and merchandising. We're also trying to develop a discipline known as small data. The marketing department, in conjunction with the IOMS department, are trying to find new streams of data that are simple, that are actionable, and inform business decisions. Because there's all this new data around us. A ton of heat around big data right now. Conferences, papers, this notion of huge data sets, incredible processing power, the ability to take analytics packages, connect these data sets, come up with patterns that predict the future. It's a bit of an arms race, and it's getting faster and faster and harder to suss out any sort of actionable items from it. And at the end of the day, data becomes information, right, when it becomes more actionable. And that is, okay, I see this, it's easily observable, and I can act on it. And the really wonderful thing about these new social media platforms is there's now a level of digital exhaust from consumer behavior that can inform an entirely new series of business decisions at a speed that makes them information and makes them actionable faster than ever before. And that's what we refer to as small data. So let's talk about how we can make decisions using basic observable data. And the first is, let's make a decision around which social media platforms are winning and which are losing. And it's key to talk about losing. One of the fundamental tenets of capitalism is you can't reward the winners without punishing the losers. And one of the wonderful things about academia is that at the core of it is the pursuit of truth. That as long as you have the data and you approach it with integrity, you can talk about winners and losers. So let's talk about both. This looks at the percentage of specialty retailers present on the following platforms year to date, and over a 12-month period. As you can see, Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook have almost near ubiquitous adoption by retailers. That's a decent proxy for their success, because if firms start investing in social media platforms, the content gets richer, the experience is nicer, more people, more brands, and it's this virtuous upward cycle. If you look at Google+, they've actually increased about 50%, from 40% to 60% adoption year on year, largely because brands are getting a bump in their search ratings if they're on Google+. Let's talk about the losers. Google had a third of brands in 2011 on the platform, spending money and programming on the platform. That has gone down by two-thirds year on year. That is a negative looking forward indicator for the shareholders of Foursquare. It means effectively that the platform is dying. Tumblr, just acquired for $1.1 billion, is flat year over year, meaning the number of retailers investing in that platform has plateaued. People talk about, was that a good acquisition? There are a lot of different stakeholders. There's a New York tech community. There are Tumblr shareholders. It was great for both. There's a lot of data saying it's not a great acquisition for Yahoo shareholders. Not all platforms are created equally around different categories. So for example, in beauty and skincare, YouTube has taken off. People seem to resonate with video and how-to videos, and the YouTube platform is doing very well in the beauty community. At the home and gift category, Pinterest has done really well. People like looking at couches and tabletop on the Pinterest platform. So sectors are starting to figure out that not all platforms are appropriate for them, and obviously some do a better job than others. Facebook, now there are two-thirds of retail brands and luxury brands spending money on the Facebook platform. There are very few mediums where two-thirds of the sector are spending media dollars. So effectively, Facebook has become an accepted media channel. That's obviously a very strong indicator for their shareholders. But if you look at what supposedly happened in the world of marketing, Facebook was supposed to take marketing out of this demographic platform, this demographic paradigm where we target people who are like each other in terms of age, race, et cetera, to it was going to be social, that you and I being friends was a stronger indicator of the brands we like than our demographics. It hasn't worked out. It's a myth. If you look at the product plan of Facebook, it has gone into another marketing paradigm, and that's behavioral data. And that is the strongest indicator of marketing likes or marketing synergies or affinity is your behavior on the web. If you go to the Beth goes to the BMW website, and so do I, that says more about what we're going to do next than our age, our race, or who we're friends or not friends with. The good news about Facebook, or the really impressive thing about Facebook, is when you have a billion people in an agile engineering workforce, they've started building something called Facebook Exchange, which is essentially behavioral targeting, and they're now responsible for 45% of the US's retargeted ads. That's an unbelievable feat in just 12 months. More agility on the part of Facebook. They were absolutely nowhere and didn't have a mobile product just 11 months ago. And now, in a short 8 months later, they're producing $2.1 in ad revenue for every user on the Facebook platform, or $2.1 billion. They went from a standstill to $2 billion with a new product in mobile. That's staggering. A billion people, a great engineering workforce, they can create unbelievable new sources of revenue. On the x-axis, we have the growth rate. On the y-axis, we have engagement rate, as indicated by shares, comments, or likes, which is just as important as the size of the community. And then the size of the icon is the average size of the community. So as you can see, Pinterest, the highest growth rate, Instagram, the highest engagement rate, and Facebook, the largest communities. These are all strong indicators for these platforms. The reason people are so excited about Instagram is the level of interaction it inspires is tremendous. The amount of content that the community actually responds to is off the charts. Tiffany had a campaign called What Makes Love True, where they produce these videos of romantic moments costing between 50 and 100 grand per video to produce. They inspired somewhere between 1,000 to 8,000 views per video. They then reached out to their user base on Facebook and asked them to upload their own pictures, their own Instagram photos of their own romantic moments. And on average, those pictures received 16,000 likes. So what you have in marketing now is the opportunity to reach out to users and create content at a fraction of the produced cost and get the same types or greater results. Let's talk a little bit about Pinterest. The reason Pinterest is so exciting will largely or likely be the largest IPO of the next 12 to 24 months should they decide to go public is you have size of community here, level of engagement here, tremendous uptake in the home market. Why is that? The average order value of traffic from Pinterest that converts to purchase is 2.5 times that of the average order value that converts to purchase on Twitter, and double that on Facebook. Pinterest might be the first social media platform that creates traffic that converts to actual purchases. You've read the news. People, when they're on Facebook, aren't in a buying mood. It seems that for whatever reason, people are in a buying mood when they're on Pinterest, which is a fantastic forward-looking indicator for the shareholders of that platform. YouTube, this will be the year of video. This is the amount, on average, of video per minute being uploaded by major brands. They've clearly decided to make this a platform, and they're investing hugely in it. If you look at upstream and downstream traffic, it supports how important YouTube is. This is the percentage of time that each of these platforms is a top 8 source of traffic to a retail brand. So Facebook, 9 out of 10 times in 2011, was a top 8 source of traffic. That's actually gone down. Facebook has actually lost a little bit of power in the ecosystem. But look at YouTube. YouTube has doubled as a source of traffic from 20% to 40%. It is gaining traction in the ecosystem. Let's talk about losers. Twitter. I love Twitter. It's the only social media platform I use. However, if you look at IBM's study, in terms of all the sites that they host, they could not register any discernible traffic converting to actual commerce. None. That is a negative forward-looking indicator. If you look at Foursquare, about 2/3 of brands claim their place on Foursquare, so someone could check in and they would offer some sort of opportunity. Now only 1 in 6 brands is doing anything on Foursquare. Again, another negative-looking indicator. So to summarize, the platform's losing relevance, Foursquare, Twitter, Tumblr, the it girl, kind of the hot property right now, Pinterest, increasing relevance, Instagram and YouTube, and Facebook still have to be there because of the size of these platforms. So who's next? Vine, 6-second looping videos, with just 12 months from launch, 2/3 of brands now have an official presence on the platform. A very optimistic piece of data. I don't know how many of you have seen some of the ads that are running, but brands are trying to figure out how to run these 6-second commercials. If you look at the number of posts and the size of the Vine communities, to a certain extent, it's almost like an x-ray into how innovative a retailer is. You can do simple charts to see who's thinking most forward, who's most aggressive about innovation by looking at new platforms and seeing things like basic community sizes, number of posts, et cetera. However, don't be jealous. We tend to romanticize tech pioneers and tech CEOs, and we read all these stories of the instant riches. This is an incredibly brutal and competitive atmosphere. Yesterday, Instagram launched their own video, and it'll be very interesting to see if Vine just kind of withers, if you will. Now let's talk a little bit about the social media environment or ecosystem in China. Sina Weibo has become the default platform. Youku and Kaishen, the video platforms. But at our last conference, we were talking about Renren, and that's basically fallen off the map. The social media environment in China is actually more robust than it is in the US. In the US, you could describe it as Facebook and the Seven Dwarves. In China, there are new social media platforms punching up almost every year and then others going away. It's a very competitive and robust and healthy ecosystem. The latest, the hottest platform in the world, WeChat, reaches 70% of 3G phone users in China. The unique thing about this platform, it was born on a mobile phone, which makes it exceptionally popular among young people. It's grown from 200 million people to 400 million just in the last 6 months. This may be the first global brand to come out of China. China's famous for taking global brands and consuming them and loving them, but it's hard to think of one global brand. We love their products. Their products have gone global, but their brands have not. This brand, WeChat, is one of the top 10 downloads in 43 markets. A social media platform born on a mobile phone may be the first global brand to come out of China. Very fragile community. The number one social media network in Japan just a few years ago was Mixi. Then Facebook overtook Mixi. Now it's Line. In Korea, it was Naver, then it became Facebook. Now Facebook has been unseated in the last 6 months by a new platform called KakaoTalk. This is a wildly competitive atmosphere. Second big thing we're talking about in our curriculum, low-touch luxury. We think there's a big trend towards brands getting out of their own way in terms of selling goods to people, and that's why e-commerce has taken off at such a velocity in the world of luxury. This is the stated reasons why people like shopping online versus going into a store. And as you would imagine, it's convenience, limited proximity, bargains, more variety. But far and away, the number one reason people say they prefer shopping in e-commerce versus in stores is to avoid the sales associate. And as you go into the developing market, it skyrockets. We tend to think about innovation as adding new things. A lot of the innovation in luxury and in retail is about taking things out. We want low touch. We want people out of our way. The growth rates are over-indexing versus traditional e-commerce. What's the reason for this? We are raising a new generation of wealthy introverts. Think about the way we used to interact with each other around the family table. We'd watch TV together. We'd fight over the remote. No one fights over the remote anymore. Everyone has their own remote. We're raising more and more kids in single-parent households. People consume media as a lone experience. As a result, customer service has taken on a new meaning. Customer service is about allowing you to do things on your own. We used to think of customer service as high touch, Tiffany, Vuitton, someone offering you water, hotels that had a butler for every room. The number one customer service site in the world, as evidenced by its consumers, is Amazon. What is real luxury? Luxury is avoiding this line. Luxury is reducing interaction when you travel. You can now print out your boarding pass, even get through customs without interacting with an individual. Think about the way we used to buy cars. We used to go to that area, that part of town, go in, kick the tires, do a test drive, talk to a sales associate, read all that fantastic material. Now how do we buy cars? We go online, we pick the options, we price the car, we go into the dealership, and we say, this is what I want. I know how much you paid for it. This is what I'm willing to pay. One of the largest retail infrastructures in Western society are US auto and Western European auto dealerships. They've effectively been rendered into warehouses because of the internet. No one buys cars any longer in dealerships. They just take delivery of them. Drivers, the hottest startup in the US right now is Uber. What it's done is it's taken things out. You no longer have to talk to anybody. You no longer have to interact with the driver. You just get out of the car. Buying glasses is not easy. It's an embarrassing experience trying on glasses. It's a highly social, interactive experience. Warby Parker says, pick 5 pairs of glasses. We send them to you. You send back 4. No human interaction. The Regent Street store for Burberry, they've tried to wrap, most retailers have tried to take their offline stores and mimic them online. They've done the reverse. They've said the low-touch luxury of online stores needs to be brought offline. You take a trench coat off a rack, you swipe the RFID code, and all the information about the product comes up. No interaction necessary, and you can buy it right there. Estee Lauder is reporting that when people go into a department store and begin interacting with an app on their iPad on the counter, they're more likely to convert to purchase than when they begin interacting with a sales associate. This has huge implications for our society. You're going to have the middle class. Retail are great jobs. They've built a lot of middle class families. You can get by on a retail job. It's the jobs that our kids have in between summers, et cetera. Those jobs are going away. They're going to low-cost labor to assemble an iPad device or to a $120,000 systems engineer. But the $30,000 to $50,000 a year retail job is essentially going away. Another great example of low-touch luxury, the Mandarin Oriental in Tokyo, and I love this technology. If you check in and you forgot your charger, which you often do, or you need breakfast, you call in or you can actually text them the request. They put the newspaper, your breakfast, the charger in a trap door, and then they turn on a light. You see the light is on. You go and you open the trap door, and there's your charger. No strangers in your room in the morning giving you breakfast. No wondering, do I tip this person? Is it rude to tip them in foreign currency? It's a lack of interaction. That is what luxury is about. We only have a certain amount of capacity for decision-making all day. So if someone can take decision-making out of the process, that makes us feel luxurious. That is a true leisure. Private air travel is not about saving time. If you look at the data, you really don't save much, if any, flying private. The reason people love flying private and will continue to pay $5,000 to $10,000 an hour for private jet travel is the lack of interaction. Final topic, what is the best business in the world? We would argue that the best business in the world is going to be luxury and specifically beauty. And there's a wonderful thing happening globally in terms of our consumer population, and you could largely refer to it as the consumerization of the global population, and that is only one third of the Earth's inhabitants are consumers, meaning that they have enough disposable income to buy things beyond housing, basic housing and basic food. Think about that. Only one third of us have the opportunity to go buy things, whether it's education or a pair of shoes or something nice for our kids. That is going to flip over the next 15 years, and it's going to go to two-thirds. That's an exciting statistic, that we're going to go from one-third of the world to consumers to two-thirds. I often think about all the headline news about how terrible things are. I was thinking about, I think every increase in broadband that we have on the internet makes us more stressed out. I don't know how many of you were watching live the pursuit of the Boston bombers, but at one point you could go to a website, which I did, and you could see the thermal map of the shape of a person hiding in a boat live, knowing what he had done, knowing what was about to happen to him. That is highly stressful. But the reality is, we have never been safer. The people in this room are less likely to die at the hand of another human being than they have been through history. But the internet makes us more and more stressed. We are going to have a doubling in the population of people who can consume things. Beauty is a wonderful business. It's part of our history. The Egyptians took soil to act and put them on their faces to accent their eyes and their cheekbones. In China, you had people using egg whites and crushed petals to paint their nails and their lips to express their wealth. The aristocracy launched an industry in France that is the largest contributor to GDP with these incredible artisanship that made people look expensive and made them look differentiated and made them look attractive. This is also a great industry on a number of levels. In addition to the growth rate and the opportunity for jobs, it's an industry that has been one of the few global businesses where the majority of the wealth has accreted to women. Helena Rubinstein, Elizabeth Arden, Estee Lauder, a 4'10" Jewish woman from the ghetto in Poland who began mixing eye creams in her brother's pharmacy, a woman who started selling cosmetics out of the back of her trunk. These were women who were entrepreneurs, and they became, by virtue of that time, on a risk-adjusted or on an inflation basis, worth several hundred million, if not billions of dollars. We tend to think of luxury as this cute industry. It's an enormous industry. The market capitalization of the New York Times Company is $1.5 billion. The market capitalization of Michael Kors is $11 billion. The market capitalization of the largest communications company in the world, WPP, is $18 billion. The market capitalization of Estee Lauder is $25 billion. The market capitalization of Deutsche Telekom, the largest telco and the largest economy in Europe, is $38 billion. If you're wearing a Cartier, a Panerai, or purchase something for Van Cleef and Arpels, you purchase something from Richemont that has now a market cap of $45 billion. Even looking at LVMH, they see their growth in beauty. This is where they used to get their operating profits. It used to be fashion and leather goods, primarily the Vuitton brand. Now the majority of their profits or their growth, the majority of their growth is coming from Sephora, a standalone beauty center. And as you can see, selective retailing is now 16% growth versus the rest of their organization, which either is flat or in the mid-single digits. I was talking to Professor Bruce Buchanan last night about the importance that consumers have a smell for authenticity, and they have a smell for when companies are not only doing well, but doing good. And beauty is one of those industries. There's some great stories in beauty. This is Madame C.J. Walker, or Sarah Breedlove, who was born in the Mississippi Delta in 1876. The first sibling in her family, not born into slavery, suffered from such poverty that the water in her household was so foul that their hair used to fall out. Had to leave home, an abusive home, at the age of 14 with her husband, and began mixing potions and oils that reduced hair loss from people who were living in these foul conditions. She is the first self-made millionaire in Western society, first self-made female millionaire. That's a nice story. It's nice. People smell in beauty and in luxury that not only is it meaningful because it makes people feel better about themselves, but it's profound because a lot of the wealth, whether it's today Luciana Prada, Tory Burch, Natalie Massenet at Prada, Tory Burch, and Net-a-Porter combined, respectively, are generating hundreds of millions of dollars in shareholder value for women. What other industry is doing that right now? It's not technology, it's not finance. It's luxury and it's beauty. I'm gonna wrap up here. The three of us teach about 1,000 students a year. I'd like to think over the course of our careers, we'll teach 50,000. This is the first slide you saw, this is the last slide you'll see in this session. One, we wanted to provide you a window into the classroom. These are largely the lectures or the type of lectures that we're giving to the students who take our classes each year. Also provide some texture on the word possible. Our tagline is an education impossible. Wikipedia defines possible as the skill and capacity to do stuff. I was talking to our young admittees outside this morning, and I was asking them what they did or what they were doing. They weren't interested in talking about that. They wanted to talk about the classes and what they could do. There's so many measures of the success of a society. We look at GDP, we look at the amount of debt, we look at risk indices. But at the end of the day, the societies we see are failing are the ones that are reducing the capacity and the abilities of its young people. We are expanding those capacities and abilities at a scale that's unprecedented in the Gulf, in the US, and now in China. When we say possible, we are delivering against that. The kids here are not only getting good jobs and developing economic security, they literally can spend 2 years deciding what is my capacity and ability to do what I want, where I want, and have an impact that is only limited by the scope of my imagination. I like that. That is something that makes teaching meaningful, and we do that every day. I'm going to wrap there, and I'm going to invite you to enjoy the fact that we are consumers and get to consume wonderful things. We're having a champagne reception hosted by the House of Moet & Hennessy. Please join us. Thank you for your time today, and enjoy the rest of the conference.